Yes, I think we should put all the notes on the typing pad so that everybody can work, and that's going to be the URL.
Okay.
Could you copy the URL in IRC?
You lazy bums. Yes, of course, gladly. Are we just in the team channel? Is that it?
Yes.
I hit create pad, right, because otherwise we won't have one.
No, he already created.
No.
Race condition.
I'm actually load testing the Titan pad now, like with 25 people. It probably works. Depends. If you don't use NAT, we all have different IPs.
Oh,
come
on. And we don't use NAT.
All right. So, thanks for showing up in such large numbers, and also thanks so much to the video team. I think this is the first time that we have video ready to go before that conf starts.
There's still an issue to the external.
Great work.
so
welcome to everybody also out there listening. The point of today is not, I don't think we're going to, I'm sure we're not going to be walking out of this with a new conference management system or any solutions to our problems, but I think we're getting together today because we realized that our current solution is suboptimal, and a lot of people want to improve on this, but we don't really have a very clear idea of where we're going to go. There are a couple of conference management systems out there. Maybe Alison later can give a word or two. You've done a lot of research on this already and done a survey, but you know, maybe and maybe not. But these other conference management systems were not written for DevConf, and some people disagree with this. Everyone who thinks DevConf is somewhat of a special conference, and in many ways it is, and in many ways it might not have to be. So none of the existing systems out there are really made to fit our requirements. So today, what we want to do is come up with a shared idea, a shared vision of what we need. What would the system that would really help us doing the organization of DevConf have to provide, and what scope should the system have? I mean, questions like, should volunteer management be included? Should scheduling be separate? Do we want accommodation in there, and so on? All these kind of questions, I think, we're going to ask ourselves. And one way of doing this would be to think about the sort of entities that we're dealing with. And once you started thinking about entities, then very soon you have graphs, and then you think about database design, and no, we don't really want to be doing database design, at least not in a detailed level at all. But thinking about it maybe, and this is just a proposal, thinking about it coming from the database perspective might allow us to identify questions that we should discuss and form a clear answer to. So this is just a proposal. If there are no questions from your side, or if you don't have any other proposals, I could start, but maybe somebody else wants to chime in, or if there are any questions, please go ahead.
Comparison.
Good morning,
Do we have a mic?
Does it talk to the
camera? Yeah, so I was wondering if it's worth anything going through the comparison that I think Alison compiled.
It's actually David Asher from Mozilla who compiled it, although I pulled in a bunch of people from conferences I worked on to make sure they could do it.
So the comparison that David Asher?
Is that a thing?
David Asher.
That David Asher and Addison worked on.
Do we have a link? Can we put it in?
Yeah. On the Titan pad?
Yeah. Do we want to look at these solutions before we know what we need? Or do we want to think about what we dream of and then look at which of those suit?
So what I found most useful from the list of comparisons was all the limitations that everyone had faced. And many of them were limitations that we would also hit. Some of them would be irrelevant to us. So I actually found it fairly useful in the sense of even if we wanted an ideal solution, what would it look like? Some of those pinpoints are things that it really should be fixed. But
okay. Well, should we then have a go with this? Do you wanna just briefly talk about it, Alison? That's this.
For
stuff,
now, you
brought
it up. Was there something specific that you want?
No, I don't understand much about it.
Okay. I would say there's a whole lot of detail here, and it will probably just bog down the meeting, and we'll spend too much time on it. So, pass the link around in IRC, people can look at it, and then while we're going through the list of things, I'll scan through quickly and see if there's anything we need to add to our wish list.
Okay, so for now, that's just a resource.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, then let's define the meeting target to be common understanding of needs and identification of fundamental questions surrounding our organization processes. Okay. Kind of difficult to know how to start this, but my suggestion would be that I'm gonna look at it from a database perspective and just give you some sort of idea, and then maybe we can build it bottom up from there on. And whenever you hear a point where you're like, yeah, that bothered me, or I think this could be done better in this way from our perspective, then please just chime in. So this is going to be ASCII art, but maybe we can improve on it somehow later. I think the very first item that everybody faces, our attendees face, is going to be the question of authentication, right? And what we have at the moment is single sign-on, Elioth, Debian, whatever, and that generally creates an object in the database, and then that object gets linked to a user profile. But I really don't know how to, like, I was hoping for a whiteboard of pens, and it's been a bit easier. So then we have a user profile, and the user profile is the sort of like long-lived data. I don't know how many of you remember Penta, but I really like the fact that every single year I could just come to the conference and all I had to do was log in and click a checkbox, I'm attending this next conference, because all my data was still in there. And that's the sort of permanent data, so that's what I would call it. I would say in the profile is the permanent personal data, like your address and gender, all these kind of things. But not necessarily the conference-specific type of data, for instance, the question about t-shirt size or about which level you're attending at as a corporate or as a standard participant. When we have this profile, then I don't know how exactly Penta did it, but I think they're very similar to in this respect, Penta and Summit. Summit currently has this idea of a conference or a summit. Let's just call it a conference. So, for instance, that would be DevCon 15 as an instance of this entity. And through the, I'm gonna love this, through the attending of a conference. What was this thing, cut and paste, they do with computers sometimes? There you go. Through attending a conference, you generate a relation between the two, and that is whatever you want to call that. I don't really have a name for it right now, but maybe we can just call it an attendance.
So, in Python was person, profile after person and then conference person.
A conference person being a person attending a conference.
A conference, a specific conference.
Yeah. And attendance is really the sort of place where you put all the stuff that you expect to kind of change between each year. I mean, okay, maybe t-shirt size, it doesn't change for us very much anymore because we're all too old and all that kind of stuff. But I would put that here, and if you disagree, we can do that wherever else. But I'm just trying to give you some sort of...
I think we are going too much on the details.
Yeah.
And in details,
yeah.
There are a lot of small problems that need...
We're really not trying to put all the details there now. I'm trying to give you sort of a picture, and I'm happy for you to take over. I'm bootstrapping this. I'm not trying to design this by myself with 25 people watching me typing ASCII art on iPad. So it's just a sort of idea of what you mean, but what I mean when I say this attendance. But I think there is a shared understanding anyway. So.
Yeah.
I mean,
so
I was going to do et cetera. Maybe I was going to put another thing in there. There's another aspect to this, and Summit does this wrong, in my opinion, at the moment, which is that at the moment there is a sort of global table that has the registration level. And so professional. What?
That's not in database schemas right now.
Hmm?
That's not in database schemas right now.
Okay.
I think probably, well, with the people who are here, they probably have a whole lot of ideas of what they need, but they're coming at it more from a new perspective. So let's start there.
Let's address what we're dissatisfied with. Let's find out what we're dissatisfied with, and then
as I said,
consider
it was a proposal.
For example, the problem with the registration level that you're trying to mention is that it's associated with the profile and not with the conference, right?
That it's global.
So it's global, right. So we agree that there are certain fields, let's not go into detail into exactly which, but
is
there are certain fields.
Is someone taking notes of this, right? Because this isn't going to capture it.
So what I was saying is that we agree that there are certain fields that have to be in the profile and certain fields that have to be in the conference person, and then like we need to decide what goes where, and but we should not use this meeting to decide where each field goes.
Hodge still raised a comment on IRC, which is he thinks one needs a code package that does a few central things well and then hooks up to external sites for complex things like buying tickets and merchandise. This is the way after all it's designed to be hyperlinked.
What is designed to work?
He's saying keep the conference management a bit small and link out to other systems for other things. Like we have a separate volunteer system if you need.
Separate slash subsidiary?
Yes.
Yeah.
This is the web. Okay. Yeah.
Can I just note for the record, if I do something wrong, just edit it.
Yeah, that's the point.
So if we're not going to do database schemas now, we should probably start at a higher level. And I do love what Manduk said. Like, let's actually think about what our ideal system would be like. What is it that we really want? Because we have done a lot over the past year and longer, kind of, well, you know, with Pentamark and then Summit, well, it works like this, we're kind of stuck with this, but wouldn't it be nice if we could change this and this? And we've just focused on very, very tiny, what can we improve just a little bit to make it better? And I think like folks like registration are going to have a whole lot of perspective on that, because they're the ones who work with it all the time.
Because we haven't done white balance.
I don't know, have you had any thoughts on working with Summit, how you would actually like it to work better?
Well, concretely, a lot of it has to do with just being able to actually get in. We've had so many bloody complaints about Alio.
Yeah.
We've had It's not exactly ideal that accompanying people have to get their own alley off account.
Yeah, I think the whole SSO thing is probably
it's a lovely idea, it should remain an option. But, I mean, freedom and everything, that it should also be possible to just get a specific login for whatever system we end up in.
The implication of that is that people can end up being registered twice in multiple logins.
You can make yourself 5 alley logins if you want to as well. And you have to in case you have kids and a wife and
which is why I feel that if you're going to bring accompanying attendees, they should be easily their records should be easily editable from the
and
that they don't have to get separate logins if they don't want them.
And that should be true both for families and for company accounts. So there would like Ubuntu has like 10 plus people here and they get kind of central invoice and everything, and the people that attend actually don't know anything about the process. So
it depends. I mean, even canonical employees are people in their own right.
Can I just ask something about the process, how the group would prefer to do this? Like, this what you just raised, this idea of SSOs, of course, this is sort of how I wanted to start with, this would be the first problem that I would have identified and then represented a possible solution in the database schema. I don't want to go to technical at all, but is it okay if we take these things and then quickly suggest how it could be done differently, or do we want to first accumulate
the
first
part?
Can we
just do
collect
the
issues
okay.
first
yeah.
and
okay.
then address and then possibly work through them later?
But otherwise, it's a great idea.
But so the issue is creating an Alice account is too much work
for a lot of people.
For, yeah,
and they get very.
But do we really want to have our own out, or do we instead want to like plug in to other outs that are not Alio? Twitter.
So, well, no. My opinion is.
Facebook.
Oh, well. My
she
opinion is that there should
Google
be,
Earth.
You know, one or for all sorts of DevConf things, but that could then apply to.
Right.
You know,
okay, that was another point, like the wiki. Do we want to have the same out as a wiki?
Maybe. But sort of for volunteer sign up, actual conference registration, etc., that could be one sign on. Because sort of DevConf sign ups don't really, aren't really strictly speaking related to what you end up doing in Debian. And I always thought that was a bit dubious anyway. So.
Solutions can be discussed later.
Yeah, but this was more like, not the exact solution, but what the goal we are looking for. Do we want to have our own sign-up, or do we want to plug into other sign-ups that already exist? Like, we are currently...
I mean, it's one more password to remember.
I think we will have SSO and an additional... because SSO is already two systems.
Yeah,
and then
we build the third system,
and then the people can choose. If
yes.
they have a IoT account, they choose IoT account. Debian, they choose Debian.
I mean, the fundamental problem here is that Debian doesn't have a single SSO that allows a distinction between people who are Debian developers and people who are just new members of the community. That's the fundamental problem.
It's not
yeah.
DevConf's problem.
With that, dash guest suffixes.
Can I add, as somebody who's not a
Debian
signing up with the Alliance, creating an Alliance guest account, worked absolutely fine. It's as good as an SSO for somebody who doesn't need the full Debian SSO. It seemed to work just fine.
The advantage of that is that it gets people to bother to sign up for Alioth. They might have to do some work on it.
Not necessarily.
Not a job.
My 3-year old does
exactly.
it. Will do some
yeah.
work, but like you know, my mom was going to attend on Saturday, and she needs an Alioth account. I don't think. Do we then agree that that SSO or some sort of like flexible plugin solution is what we want, what we have, and so on, and then we can talk about what the plugins are, whatever allows us to, you know, not have to sign an NDA and gag agreement, then we can use that because it's actually convenient for our users. But then there is also the problem of possibly having multiple authentications coming into the system associated with the same person.
Yes, people forgetting where they've logged in.
Right.
Otherwise, possibly the possibility of associating multiple logins with one record, but that
yeah.
might be too complex.
No, it's
no,
normally
should,
what you
should,
do, you merge them together.
Because
otherwise we
people
end up with like
that,
seven
become developer then want to use,
yes,
but you want
yeah.
the old data.
Because,
so.
I mean, I became a DD between Portland and here. I have two accounts. It would be lovely to have them completely merged, but...
Let's take this step back to a higher level. We want to simplify sign-on. It's too hard at the moment.
Yeah.
And then we go to the next one.
Can I make one small point, that when you sign up for a conference, you may well want to get somebody else to pay for it, and having the ability
oh,
for the...
Oh, so payment details on
so
a different tab altogether.
Well, so when I've been to professional conferences, I've signed up, and I've had to go into the office of the person who's paying for it to sign up and type his credit card details, because he wouldn't do that. He wouldn't do that, so he had to know my t-shirt size and everything, and that's a whole mess. So I want to tell him my t-shirt size and fill in that bit, and generate an invoice that he can separately pay.
That would be
pretty
yeah,
nice.
Although,
I think
payments are different every year, so it's...
Yeah.
But this upfront invoice is, I think, a quite good idea. If the now we're really
yeah.
dreaming, right? But if the system would be able to generate an invoice, that would be really helpful, because that's a lot of manual work, and we found quite a few people where we kind of still don't have the money because it doesn't work so easily.
I mean, now this is probably something other than registration. Just a quick note to that. Invoicing is not just generating the invoice, but it's running after people paying invoices. And if we don't have a back office that actually takes care of this and looks at what the outstanding receivables are and then pings people and runs after them and so on, it doesn't work. This is why for this year we chose to have to require people to give us money before they get their room keys and badges, because there's no other way to ensure that the money flows efficiently if we don't have someone sitting in an office and doing this every day. So I'm not sure how invoicing works. What could work is maybe outsourcing the whole process to a provider out there that does the handling of payments.
No.
Why not?
It depends on the venue.
It depends on?
On the venue, on the depot.
Yeah, I think money will depend a lot on the country, on how that country will handle the money, where the money will flow. I don't think we should discuss money.
But there are worldwide providers that we can just register the conference with, and then they.
Or something.
Yeah. Sorry. I mean, I think this is an important point to ask ourselves. Would we consider this? And if the answer is clearly no, we wouldn't. We don't want to consider someone out there handling payment, which is something that really needs proprietary systems at some point in time anyway. There's nothing we can do about it unless we become a bank. And that's hard. What are the reasons that speak against it? Why?
The problem you're going to have with going with one provider is they aren't able to provide financial services in every country that
I think it's difficult to convince people that we can do such a system.
We used Click and Pledge last year for everything. It wasn't difficult.
Not for everything.
Yeah, but for all the payments from the people. I'm talking about registration of the people right now, management of the people.
Right. So last year, the university was paid directly,
yeah.
and then the conference fee was paid by Click and Pledge. So there were two separate payments that had to be done.
Okay.
Well, I mean, the payments should remain separate, in my opinion.
But
yeah, I see. Until the invoice is okay, we can even generate the invoice, but how it's going to be processed, people are going to pay, it's the company paying, where to pay, this is,
yeah.
this can be found out later, but.
Sorry. I was going to say, if we're going to generate an invoice, we also need to then be able to get feedback from however we get paid, that the invoice is being paid, so that people's record can be cleared.
Yep.
It depends how it happens in that specific year.
Yeah.
I think that the idea of outsourcing invoicing or selling our invoices to someone else for refinancing is a very good one, because it lessens our work so much. And if this is something that we don't want to consider because we're Debian, therefore we have to do everything ourselves, then we have to agree on that, and so that becomes big part of our vision.
We might have wandered a little far from the
summit
replacement here.
Yeah.
So it's an interesting idea. Let's move on. Do you have anything else from registration that's sort of like summit?
So related to registration, the common thing when multiple people are coming from one company is that the company secretary wants to register them all
yes.
so they can all get paid.
Yes.
So you kind of need to be able to create a profile on someone else's behalf and say, this person is going to be paid for.
Oh, so this is really just another matter of
subsidiary
profile.
Yeah, but they might be DBs.
Well, so
but if
that would
you
also
generate
be able
invoices,
to be
then
you
can send the
yeah.
invoice to your the company
to
secretary.
Yes.
Pay.
Maybe.
That points to a good kind of aspect. We need good documentation, because currently the thing is, you know, we send people these promotion codes, like, because registration is closed, and now some can get still in because they are DDs or whatever, and we get them those promotion codes, but there's no documentation. So people have failed a number of times, then we kind of needed to fix a bug, and now they try again, and it's all very difficult because there's no documentation. And the same thing for secretary, right?
What do you mean by documentation?
Well, if we had a PDF which we could send to a corporate registrant, say, like, this is the process, right? This here you create an account, this is what you will receive, this is what you can give to your finance people, this is the rough timeline, so kind of this one-pager survival documentation.
You're talking about
that would help
a lot.
Yeah, for those that usually go wrong, which is first-timers, company registrations, individuals from companies that found out they are sponsoring this and now want to make something out of it. She's laughing because we have those cases. Really funny. Are we sponsoring this? Yes,
I
you
saw
are.
Our company on the sponsors list. Who's responsible?
Exactly. Like, do you have a contact in my company who did this?
And they already paid. The money was already there.
Anyway.
So yeah, I'll put documentation kind of cheat sheet on
cheat
the
sheet,
on
yeah.
the typing pad. No, I'm confident you will have worded it much better than I could anyway.
I'm not sure if it was a series of use cases.
So I think the summary of this is we want people to be able to create profiles for other people. It can be like the company secretary, or it can be like a DD creating a profile for their partner and their children and their mother and their whatever, a company person. That they want to register for the conference, but they don't want to create an alias account.
Just be aware, if you do that, you also need a method of merging multiple profiles together and saying these are all the same person.
Yeah, yes,
yes.
Okay. Correct.
Yeah.
And
we
anyway. Need that anyway. Yes, we also need merging. And we need like the ability to take control of the profile that was created by someone else.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, like if the company administrative creates the entries, then the DDs that were registered by this person,
I mean,
can also work.
That's sort of admin level.
Yeah.
Do you not want that the other way around? That the registrant, the person who's attending, wants to register and say I'm going to get them, and then the company take. But this is the person responsible for paying.
For the case of children, you don't.
And I've also had the case where a company has like 20 people going, and they just assign an assistant, just register everyone, pay, just take care of it,
right.
Do their hotels and everything. So that is a common pattern as well.
So we want both.
As long as they tell us, and we can see.
Yeah.
Done with accounts?
I had an important point, and I forgot it.
Then
One of the common problems that we have in registration is that during organization we have many teams that need to track people. So we need probably a dynamic way to create tags.
Can we postpone this just a little, because I think that's a very important, huge
point.
I think
that's what comes next.
Yeah,
it's more about the
I'm trying to gain time.
Then we
get.
No,
yeah,
I think
sorry.
This is what comes next. I think this
right.
is the next. Huge step. So we are done with accounts.
So we need who need the t-shirt, the who has paid, and every conference is different. And possibly we should the account need to be able to create a new text. We need
right, like conference
the,
dinner option, day trip option,
yes,
assessing participation. Whatever, all these fields that in every conference are different, and it doesn't make sense to be like adding a new column to the database every time. We want
yeah,
something
should be,
flexible.
Yeah, flexible, and different people can add different organ should be able to add easily.
That's fully agreed. I mean, this year it was a nightmare in terms of having Summit there, the room allocation in a spreadsheet, and all the special cases in another spreadsheet, and then getting LibreOffice to merge spreadsheets. And then, yeah, it was very difficult. So we tried to push data into the database. In the past, we've done that, like for instance, for the Assassin's game, or we put other things in there that no other registration system would ever have. And at some point in time, Carter just said, look, this is getting ridiculous. We can't just add a new field whenever somebody says, this would be nice, because I think it's just getting a mess. So finding a solution that, it's like user tags in the DTS, that would be ideal if it somehow stayed consistent.
Yeah, many times they are temporary tags.
Tags are easy enough to do in a way that doesn't impact your core implementation and are just added on.
And it gives every team their own mode of working, preserves your mode of working.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I think we agree on this 100%. We want
this. Which I think is going to make it very difficult when we look at existing systems, because
tagging is easy enough to add. It's a separate database, it's just linked by...
When you say separate database, I go crazy.
I'm not database. So I'm getting into schemas. I'm getting into database schemas. We're not getting into database schemas. Forget I said that.
We could.
Next topic. No.
Oh.
It's easy. We'll just say that. Tags are not a problem.
But what we're saying here fundamentally, and I think it would be important if we could establish consensus on this, that our goal should be that everything about our conference should be stored in one place.
Yeah.
Just don't forget backups.
Don't forget?
Don't forget backups.
Yeah. We'll use Git.
What do you mean for conference?
Yeah, what's the conference?
No, so what he means is like the room allocation should also be in the same
for
place.
For one conference or? This was a question before, or for all the conference should be the same database. This is an important question that we have also in the past. If every year we start again, and this will be easier to find tools, or if we need a multi-conference system.
Yeah, I think that's...
Like
should we just go there?
I think a multi-conference system just makes sense, because we do get a decent number of repeat customers.
The downside to it is that if we have a multi-conference system, we have to maintain it forever. Like
until we replace it with something else.
And then all those websites that were dependent on it are gone.
Mm.
Unless we have some way of exporting it, but
well,
if it's already 10 years down the line, it might be quite hard to retrofit that into the system. The nice thing about Penta was everything Penta outputted was plain HTML, so you can turn off Penta today and no one will know that it's not there anymore.
What was this?
you only need to import data from the previous conference.
It may not be portable, it may be like completely.
Yeah, if you only ever inherit for 1 year, so what if it goes 2 years down the line, we don't care. You only need, and let's face it, anybody who hasn't attended for 2 or 3 years, their details have probably changed anyway.
Yeah.
And
you might have looked at the old details on the old conference site for some reason. You know, if someone's name changed when they attend the third conference and there's some reference on the page, you don't want to start rewriting old pages.
I'm not sure what your point is, though.
Also, okay, over the years of the conference, we need to add more features, and maybe we need to make changes to the database schema to support some new thing that we start doing in the conference, right? But if the conference management system is all dynamic HTML pages, then the old conferences either get broken when we do that, or we have to spend time updating them so that they also support whatever those changes.
Unless we find a way
to... Exporting the static version when
yes.
we are done
yeah.
is
yes.
a very helpful thing.
Static version, or, and I hear the other solution being, we cut it off, but then we have to maintain it forever. We still have to have that site running forever. Take the data from the database, import it into the next database, and are free to go and use migrations only for 1 year.
So then we start with the old database.
Probably just use a profile data.
What really has to be best
in those years? Well, it's just convenient that I don't have to enter my data again if I come.
No, but
there are,
I think
there
we're
are
talking
ways
about two different
that.
Things. So what
right.
you're talking about is about the like the website, like the DevConf 10 website has
yeah.
the schedule of the DevConf. So
yes.
Yes, that's what you're talking about.
Yes, but that's part of the content management system.
Well, yeah, okay, but it's just like one specific part.
So there's two aspects of this. One is having the old websites be able to be used continuously, no matter what backend we use or changes we make over the years. The other is the data that's in the system is useful in ongoing years. But that's a data archival problem and doesn't necessarily have to be solved by using the same database for every year of the conference. There are many, many ways to solve data archival problems.
Yeah, so I think the point is we need to make sure that the website pages related to the conference are static.
Sure.
Exactly.
But
they don't necessarily have to be static, but there must be a way of making them static.
Yes, I think basically once the conference has happened, the schedule of that conference isn't going to change.
Well,
it's not retroactive. You're not retroactively
going to... Doesn't that just mean that
once
time t now is past that date, it has to be static?
Yes, thank you.
So if it's in the future, it can be dynamic.
So what
if it's in the past, it's static. Yeah.
What we really need is a system where you can run wget-m on the site on the last day of the conference, and
yeah.
then we have it forever archived.
Yeah.
This was
and we don't have to run the database forever.
Wofford
like
does that.
Yeah.
Just so you know. So of existing systems, Wofford does that. And it's not the only one, but there's...
It's not hard to do with Django either,
I think. What
in
particular?
You need to
kind
of design it from the beginning.
Yeah, no, but what does it do?
It does at the end of the conference, they press a button, it all goes out to HTML, and they're done, and the next year they just start a fresh database for the new year.
Mm-hmm.
So they do that archival. But there is the other problem of we want access to, like, say, registration data, user profiles, all the way back in time.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, it'd be really nice if we could even get those out of Pentabarf and kind of have them all accessible to whatever the next system is. So that
mm-hmm.
is not actually the same question.
That might want a separate system.
I think the thing really just pertains to the things that need to go static really are just things like scheduling.
Any public site, yeah.
Yes.
Public
whereas user profile stuff is kind of not related in the same way.
But it might actually be useful if the user profile stuff was abstracted out of the old system. It's not static. It's still a database, it's still searchable, but it's a separate system that isn't tied into the schema of whatever conference system we used that year, and then becomes easily linked into whatever system we're using today.
But this
is
precisely why I wanted to design
the
database.
Now,
we don't have to do it here, but this is what I'm getting at.
We will need to, but high level. Like, the goal here is we need to have access to the data from previous year's conferences, not just the web page, but the data,
and find some way
to do that.
But that doesn't necessarily need to turn static.
Right.
Yeah.
It probably shouldn't turn static. I mean, what's
yeah.
the,
no,
it's
I mean,
not even a benefit. If I change my name next year, then if the website is static, I should, I'm still the same person, and we're
yes.
not going to run statistical analysis on the name changes of our attendees over the last couple of years, right? So it doesn't matter anymore whether I change my name. So that the data should always be accurate.
I mean, that, does that strictly speaking end up going onto a static website?
The static website is done. It has my old name on it.
If your name was
Parkhead
Smith in 1999 and it's there in the static website, if that was your name and you changed it to like Bob Smith 10 years later, we're not going to go back and change
that's
websites. Like, you know, that was your name at the time, that's fine. It's static, we're done. But in the data that we want for registration, maybe it's actually useful to know. Oh, this person changed her name.
Okay.
I think we outlined the scope of that problem, sort of what we need the system
yeah.
to do.
The things that you just said, or we all just said, is that we want to consider having the database separate and then feeding into whatever conference management system we use, because it's also going to allow us to easily change the systems if we ever wanted to, but it allows us to define the needs that we want, and that's our database, and also the static, making the web page static post-conference is a good idea that we want. I think those two, so let's keep those as conclusions.
Okay.
And sanitary purposes, is that it?
Completely unrelated. Whatever we do, can we please have confirmation emails?
Yes, we need confirmation emails. That is like people write into registration saying, I did not get a confirmation email.
Yes. Yeah, I know.
Don't look at web pages after I press send.
maybe we need a point later on about sort of the things that we want the system to be able to do with a single click. Like invoicing, emailing, and so on.
No, but this is like when you register, you need to get a confirmation email.
Oh, that
everyone
yeah,
is expecting the email, and when the email doesn't come, they think they are not registered.
On the other hand, this is the important point that I forgot earlier. One of the problems with Alias has been that people went there to sign up, then they had to wait for somebody to check that, then they got a link, which they then had to click, and then they were back in Alias, and then they had to remember that they were actually on Summit, using that Alias account to log in.
That was a very long-winded process.
And that killed a couple of people. So there are solutions, obviously, whereby we don't need to do this ping pong. You kind of sign up, and then you get the link, and when you click it, it's done. Right?
So there's also sometimes the case of people's emails suddenly changing.
Yeah. I put that in here, up here, there.
You're still fine.
Solutions not requiring.
I do think if we can't get away from that problem first, it's a good documentation PDF. Get around that.
It means the bumpy ride, yeah.
Yes, it's not ideal, but and I was thinking you can make a play for example, Polito doesn't have an Alias account, so you can go, Polito doesn't have an Alias account, and then show pictures of how Polito is.
I'm
registering for it. So it's painful, it makes it a bit less painful.
We should look at UAD1 as a better than Debian
still
network.
I couldn't register another Alias account, which is this multiple thing. So we'll fix it for next year.
Back to your statement earlier with registering accounts. It would also be nice if some users could administer the account of other users.
We had the idea of that. We talked a little bit about that. We thought that was a good idea.
Mm-hmm. Is this the phase or not for the admin?
Oh, well, we did wonder about certain accounts just being
dependent on
that. Yeah. So, for example, somebody brings a very totally non-technical spouse. These people do exist. Who really doesn't want to faff about with their own registration. Yeah.
But they, if we have multiple profiles for
spouses. Multiple profiles linked to one account.
Yeah.
Because they may only be attending once or not every year. And you can say, you know, hello, I am such and such a person. This year I'm bringing my spouse and kids or whatever. However, next, you know, the following year, no, it's too far, they're not coming this year. Now another year is like, yes, I'm close enough, let's take them again. So this mod is then be enabled and disabled per year. Also, more children.
It's also nothing to do with how many people there are.
Yeah.
My wife is pretty technical. She's not a Debianite, and
doesn't feel like dealing with it.
You know,
it's also fine.
I sort of persuaded her that many geeks wasn't going to be a
total
disaster, and then she had to do the annual thing.
Strike non-technical. Strike not inclined to deal with the administration of their profile.
Whatever. The owner of the profile would then be able to change those data. And one idea that I had earlier was when I create, like for instance, I create Natty's profile, then with her email address, then Natty gets an email saying you are now registered. That's the confirmation email, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it could contain a link that could allow Natty to then go visit Summit, log in herself, and the profile would be shifted to your own if you wanted to take over.
That's an idea, yeah. Or if two profiles are associated, and you know, if you have to change an arrival or a departure date, there have been cases where sort of spouses or whoever have had different dates just because they hadn't coordinated with themselves. It's a good idea to be able to these profiles are associated with mine. Please change the dates for all of this.
That might be a UI
thing,
JavaScript.
What you were saying though, the reverse case is also, you know, you might both independently register and then one of you can't actually be bothered to do all the stuff, and so you can the other person be in charge of my account.
Pass on the token and then they could associate. Yeah, I think. I don't think that's going to be hard to implement.
Yeah.
No big deal. Here's.
You can get from this report.
And
the high
school
calculation
stuff. I think it would be important while we are on the. I'm sorry, Judith,
do you
want
to
go ahead?
No, should those sub accounts be completely dependent on the main account? That means that the main account, if it is deleted, then the sub account is also deleted?
Or
will there be independent accounts once created?
I think there will not be no main account.
No, it's just an authentication profile. That's where they are all tethered to.
Mini authentication.
Oh, yeah, there is
no
authentication.
And it's we could do instead of cascade delete, instead of deleting all of them, if an authentication thing was deleted, we could reassociate them to the sort of like DevConf orga.
By the way,
we
don't delete anything.
Yeah, we
people
don't
can
delete
only delete profiles, so it's not really a problem.
No, but it might. Might happen, it might come up, it might be necessary.
Yeah.
And we do have to have a sort of DevConf orga authentication special role anyway, where for instance the walk-in registrations can easily be done. So they don't all have to happen under Natty's name, which makes no sense. I mean, she's a very nice person, but she doesn't need to have everything.
She has a lot of dependents, you know.
Well, I am the auntie of 500 people for a week, so.
All right, do we want
but
this? And
yes.
Does it scale?
There should be, say, an on-site registration user.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
That can then
front desk role.
Those profiles can then be released to their owners if they so desire in future. Because I think frequently on-site registrants are just people having a bit of a look-see. I haven't analyzed how much repeat custom we get from people who just search or look.
It's probably low.
It tends to be local users
that would
be interested.
Right, then okay, so what do we want to have for local people? What
all sort of short term visitors.
So what would be the ideal solution for this?
I suppose in that case, the authentication thing would just be, you know, the dedicated on-site registration thing, and then profiles that hang from that.
Well, just put them in the list, right? Isn't like what we now do with the stickers, isn't that sufficient?
I'm asking what's the ideal, not what's sufficient.
I actually find collecting as little data as possible ideal, because, you know,
you don't have to maintain it.
You don't have to maintain it. You know, in Germany, for example, we would be legally obliged to delete all the data which we do not need for our business processes anymore. That means we have to actually yank the whole database after the event, because there is no legally acceptable reason why we keep it. Now, that said, there's probably a 500 euro fine if you violate it, and nobody has ever been sued for that.
Also, the German Verein is not running Xamarin.
Yeah.
Exactly, so, and you definitely don't have a Datenverarbeitung Auftrag contract, so that's
not really legal. I think we're fine.
Let's go back to my question. My question was, how do we envision
this
the ideal way that
Walker.
This isn't on video.
Yeah, if we're in video,
I see.
I haven't really thought about it in detail. Sorry.
I think that it should be a way to.
It happens in the conference. At Bangalore, we had some. At Portland, I think we had a fair few.
What's a fair few, like 5 or 10?
20 or 30? Okay. There was actually quite a lot in Portland.
So
yes,
so
because
you have
there's
the
all
line,
the
then.
Students, there's sort of local geek community, if it's a very geeky place already. Sort of geeky, but not necessarily Debian, but they want to sort of meet other geeks. So there is a, well, actually at Switzerland we also had a lot of people also come for the birthday party.
Mm-hmm.
We just did that as a text file list, but
how about say something?
Sorry.
Yes, also in Nicaragua it was too complex to make people for Debian Day to register in system, so we have a separate system. But I think the ideal way is to have a simplified registration without Elliot and with a simple
just sort of name, email address.
But this
is
was also a discussion with Madak, with Martin. Probably we need to split the accommodation and the simple registration. So the people will do only the normal registration,
mm-hmm.
and for accommodation then the people will have a normal form.
Yeah, I was going to say for Debian Day or whatever that event's equivalent is called, we want something where we can generate a badge, you know, quickly, but we don't necessarily need the whole, shebang.
How about we do something like a kiosk, you know, we just have two machines there with the Summit website, people can register it and they get an ID, and then that ID, either we have a label printer attached
mm-hmm.
right there,
you
or...
You do need that staffed though, because otherwise they can just...
And they need to be not registering via audio.
No, obviously it needs to... This could all happen under the role account, kiosk 1 and kiosk 2.
Yeah.
And
what's
the scenario where people are going to abuse it?
Pinta had such scenario. Many times we had the two computers to register. The people can directly register,
mm-hmm.
but I think they go mainly to front desk and front desk register because it was too complex.
Yeah.
People don't want to type.
I mean, on big events where there's going to be a lot of external visitors, we can just have a kiosk, but as long as they're staffed, I really don't like the idea of it just zapping.
Yeah, but then it depends a lot on staff, and I think this is a general problem that we have all over the organization, that the expectations of our attendees are at the moment, just make me feel like a king when I come here, but I'm not going to pay. And, I mean, in all positive senses and all negative senses of what that sounds like. If registration can do this, if front desk can do this, all the better, but I think we should not be afraid in the future, even more so than in the past, to tell people, no, you have to do this, otherwise you're not going to attend. And, you know, shift the rules a little bit over and outsource some of the dirty work that we're doing manually all the time as an Oregon team to the people themselves.
What is the scale? Are people getting three badges instead of one, or lying about their name? Or, you know, are we checking the ID for this?
Well, I think as Debian, we don't really care about people lying about their names. Given that we have lots of people who use pseudonyms, that's
exactly, so that's not a problem.
Okay.
Do we really care if we have two to fake people and stuff?
No, it's...
sometime
we
might.
We won't.
Yeah. Sometime we might.
But why would it be built in?
Well,
don't we know?
Because we're Debian.
I think also for things like fire safety, we want an accurate picture of how many people are actually in the building. So it just makes sense to have somebody attending the machines, just making sure that...
Yeah, we can get a thing and just walk up.
This could happen if the person has his own computer, no? And do the same.
No, that's it. If you're on the ID patches.
My concern with kiosk registration is just I've implemented it before, and it's a massive pain to get it right to the point that people don't make huge errors when they're using it. So you probably end up having someone there attending just to make sure that they have a backup when the system confuses them and they need help.
This is incredibly something like airport checking.
Really literally have no other option other than
the one
address.
Person.
But it is really nice when you can get it working. So.
Well, for the purpose of our, if we are in a place, I think the system should have provisions to force us to enter certain data if we're, for instance, legally required to collect those data.
Mm-hmm.
But then we kind of like shift per conference, we can shift the level of requirement for the, like,
I mean,
somehow
it can,
this
it can
be
just
recorded.
Be really simplified whatever interface.
Yeah, and then if it's three or four fields that you just fill in and then you click enter and that's it. I mean, okay, some people are going to have problems with that and then we help them. We are probably also not going to have a blind terminal set up. So, you know, like, I mean, we need to cater to all these special cases. But I would like to assume that the most part of attendees of this conference can fill out a web form. Am I wrong?
Yes, because they come with the weirdest browsers available.
No, you go to kiosk. That's why they get a kiosk, that's right.
Well,
I mean, they possibly
the
book the plane.
Or the printer stops working, or the...
That's why the kiosk is at the front desk, and when
okay,
the front desk is not busy with other things,
well, exactly,
they can help.
Exactly, so you have one front desk person just kind of keeping an eye on it.
Yeah.
I mean, I think... I don't think some of these look good like this, but just sort of, you know, so-and-so, this is your department for this situation.
Okay, so...
It's a good feature to add, let's put it in. It's not an absolute requirement. It's
I did
that
kiosk
like
registration.
Yeah, but making sure that it's like a wish list and not a requirement.
We did it twice. We said it would be nice and a wish to have, not a have to have.
Okay, that's perfect. Yeah,
I think that's
quick. I added something to data here before we move on, maybe just quickly. So this year, for the first time ever, we really had to deal with people taking a break from DevCon and going away. And with the date ranges, that's kind of really hard. I hope that in the future the system is going to have the days associated with the conference.
Also,
and then
Penta had that. Didn't Penta have availability by day?
Yeah.
Even availability by time
did.
Range?
Did.
But it
no,
was not
it
for accommodation.
No, but
we
can
make it be for
we
accommodation.
We can use that. We can even put meals in there.
It was
used
a lot
for...
Somebody
might
go
off-site for dinner, somebody...
But this is the sort of...
Did
they're not going to get people to check themselves.
On Penta, did anybody ever successfully fill that in a meaningful way?
I think I did.
Oh, well done.
But I have a special ability, to be honest.
But I actually think if we had the data, it would be something which registration could really do, because... there's so much information, like who's leaving and stuff, which we have. If we had a system where we could put it in, we would get more accurate data, like, you know, how many people are having lunch, how many people are there this morning, still, stuff like this, right? Doesn't necessarily mean that people are managing the data themselves.
Yeah,
I think that's sufficient if we can
make it
and
add
tweak it.
To be fair, with the catering and bits and pieces you're talking about, nobody's going to know whether they're going to buckle off site for a meal until typically 15 minutes before they're about to go off-site for the meal.
Yeah,
that's true, but there was the issue, like, if we count people per day, what does that mean for the breakfast, right? Because you know, you have 200 people arriving today, but you don't want to pay 200 breakfasts.
Because they might be arriving at 11.
Exactly. So you kind of, the maths you do is like no breakfast, which is probably wrong. You say half of the people for lunch, which is probably wrong, and you say, well, probably 90% for dinner, which is wrong too, but it kind of is okay enough to go with the venue.
Because
and
you can be,
So if we knew it better.
So if you know it, put it in. If you don't know it, well, you know, just assume.
I think the important distinction we should make here is that on the UI side, it could be as simple as adding a range, and then like, you know, JavaScript fills and ticks the boxes and whatever, and then so people aren't expected to click 12 times.
Exactly,
but
and then you can refine it if you know that you're going to be absent.
And even if you don't do that, we can use that.
Yeah.
We can actually say, we know this person is taking a break and put it in. And
but
actually
how would we know it? I think it makes
well,
sense.
When they send to
we
just
we know,
saying, by the way, I'm going to see
yeah, we get an email, and this is an exception case. I'm just saying we have, there are going to be exceptions, and the more exceptions we can think about and find a way to cater for them by making the system flexible enough, the better, the less LibreOffice spreadsheets we're going to have later on.
Marga, you know this
yeah,
about
I know.
The break, but it's
no,
not on the system for the breakfast.
No, but what I mean is, I know about six people that have now left towards CCC camp. I don't know if those are the only six people that actually left. It is possible that there are other people that also left towards CCC camp and then we didn't know because they needed to proactively tell
right,
us about
yeah.
this. So if there was like something that they could have clicked, like
yeah.
I'm not going to be present these 4 or 5 days.
I'm sorry, I thought we were about to start.
No,
I don't think we really got
yet.
The movement
okay.
Well, that's like a problem. It's all cut out. The problem is that
it's not working anyway.
No, it is working.
Oh, it's working again.
Yeah, it's predominantly working, it's just I can't see it. I don't know, but yeah, I can sometimes not. So. Okay. Okay.
Marga, you had a point.
I wanted to start a new discussion on a related topic, but unrelated to what we already discussed.
Yeah. I think we're good.
Okay, so I think the process of how registration works right now, that has been how it's been working for years, is broken. I think this is how I envision it would be better. People sign up early without stating any dates, just stating, I want to go to DevCon, I want to go to DevCon, but nothing else.
Yeah.
And I request sponsorship. So we want this early for people that want to request sponsorship, or they want to submit a talk. So they just intend to go to DevCon, but don't feed any data, just I want to go, and sponsorship talks, nothing else. And then when what we call reconfirmation time comes, we actually call it registration time, and they have to go and fill in the dates, and fill in their t-shirt size, and fill in all the data that we want to have from them.
By a certain time.
By a certain time, right. But we don't ask people to fill in their dates like 6 months before the conference, because nobody knows when they are going to be there 6 months before the conference. They just know that they want to go.
Mm-hmm.
And
so like intent and then registration.
Yes.
So that's a really good idea, because they also feel like they've registered. They lose the mail for the, you need to tick the box.
Yeah.
They know that they filled in all the data, so they're registered and they're
right.
Very surprised.
So we still sort of keep two phase, but not in quite the same way.
Yeah,
right,
just,
in the first phase, it's just the minimal thing,
yeah,
that if you're not,
intent. I'd like to be there.
Right.
So
we don't even have to know the grand
figures.
Yeah, okay.
It's
basically, I'm interested in going and signing up for my videos. Yeah, but so, it is important for people that want to request sponsorship or that want to submit a talk.
Mm-hmm. Or want
but
to travel and want to book plane tickets.
Well, but
no.
In that case, you don't need to pre-register. If you are not going to get sponsored and you don't need to submit a talk, you don't need to pre-register. You
unless,
only need to register.
Unless, of course, I would like accommodation, and I want to know that I have got accommodation before I buy a plane ticket.
No, but that's
you often
my
don't
point.
Find
accommodation
that out
comes
before
later.
The conference.
Accommodation comes at the registration time, not at the pre-registration time, because otherwise we are dealing with dates that are completely unknown, because people fill in whatever dates they think of, which are not real, and then when reconfirmation time comes, a lot of people just forget to check those dates.
And there's also a problem right now, because you can't tell if someone's actual dates are exactly the same as the default. You can't
no
tell
default
if
they just dates.
No,
yeah.
Default
yeah.
Dates. No default dates.
Sorry,
that's
I completely disagree with you. If I'm going to go and travel, I want to know I'm leaving on this date, coming back on this date, before I book my plane tickets. I want to know I've got accommodation before I book my plane tickets. It's going to be very expensive to go to a different continent. A lot of people travel from not just a different country, but over different continents to get here. The earlier you know it, the better. I don't know about you, I have to book my holidays for work in January.
Yeah, I understand, but the problem is that we can't tell you
yeah.
will get accommodation mm-hmm. until reconfirmation time comes, because everybody else, I mean, you are tidy and organized, but everybody else just feels like whatever crap it is.
We're trying to avoid exactly what the problem that you're currently talking about, because we don't want Orga to be reactive. What we're trying to do is Orga to be proactive, and at the time, if you're talking about accommodation per se, for attending the conference, self-paid, I think we can guarantee that that's going to happen, because we need to figure out a way to close registrations if we're over the limit. We weren't prepared
yeah.
for this year.
I
but
think,
if you
I
are
going to
be sponsored, just let me finish the thing. If you're going to be sponsored, you will have registered your intent, and you will have gotten an email saying, yes, we accept your sponsorship, which means that, yes, you are going to get accommodation. And that information you'll get in February, like 6 months before, and you can put your...
Yeah.
I think the answer here is the early indication needs to have a tick box that says, I'm going to be requesting accommodation. And that way you've got sort of like that early, you've got that early entry into the system. You know you're not going to get in late and then like there's already 500 people before you. You've already said, and for the folks who are making the planning, that actually helps them because then they start to get a count very early on.
If you're paying your way, you should be allowed to put your dates in and it's
Well, if you pay, it's hard to
because then we say, okay, so on this date we have 300 people, we need to reserve 300 rooms. And afterwards, it turns out that reconfirmation period comes and people change their date.
If you say you're paying to come here and you're paying for everything,
can I point out the simple solution to that? Is as you pointed out earlier,
you send them an invoice.
Bill? you're taking money. You've asked to take money. I say I'm coming on this date, here's my credit card details.
Yeah.
I'll pay in about 6 months.
I don't think we're taking money with early indication.
Yeah, that's not how it works.
And we don't necessarily need dates because we can just assume, okay, if they ticked that, we'll just assume they're going to be there for the whole conference, and then when we get later on and we actually get the real dates, that's when we'll do real allocations.
We don't. Yeah, but Andy's point is that he wants to be able to go in and book everything else that goes with it.
We don't.
And he's attending as a professional person. He's throwing money at us, right?
We don't need.
And he's throwing money at the airlines and everything else.
We don't.
He wants to book it and be done.
We don't need to provide guarantees. We know we're going to organise accommodation. If we can say that if someone says they've been professionally registered and they're going to pay their own accommodation, we can say we will give you accommodation. We don't know what your dates are yet, but we'll make it happen when we know them. That's fair, right?
But that would be really cool. This is what Maddox said as well.
I think we can do that.
Once you are registered in a certain way, like you're a DD and you get sponsored, or you're a professional and...
Or you were there before we closed registrations.
Yeah.
Whatever. We guarantee you accommodation. And this line, we guarantee you accommodation, would be safe enough.
Yes.
You don't care where you sleep, you don't care like with whom in the room you have to share stuff. You will book your flight tickets anyways, but you want to make sure that you have the place and not have to hit out to, you know, whatever couchsurfing site to kind of, you know, make sure you can stay somewhere.
And the actual registration, like when we ask you to provide your actual dates, that should be as late as possible in some ways, because we want to make sure that you know, as an attendee, with reasonable certainty, that these are going to be your dates, because you are not going to look at them again and change them if your plans change.
Once you book your flights, you should be allowed to put your dates in.
Yeah.
And I just paid for my flights, so I'm definitely coming. You know?
Yes, that would be good enough.
But it doesn't have to be, though. If, for instance, you booked your flights in February, and we have the call for papers end in February, and then in March we are able to give you like a slim, like the best talks and whatever, and we open registrations, then we'll be sending you an email that says registrations are now open, now you can enter your dates. I mean,
that's fine.
And I don't think we want to allow people to do that beforehand, because it's, again, a complication of the whole process.
So you have a pre-registration period where you submit your talk, so then after a certain point you have a registration period where if you're a professional attendee you can pay, you know, you can get, and therefore there's no chance of you missing an email or anything. And once you're registered, you've got whatever you've booked. Now it might be that you want to change that, but if you've booked accommodation in a place of the conference, you've got it. Because that's what...
Yeah.
And then you can book flights and everything else.
Well, that's so. Hopefully, you book the flight first, and then you enter. Because if you book the dates first, and then you book your flights, you may end up booking your flight different.
This would be all easier if we ask people to say, if you want accommodation, there are these three places that we have, and if you quote that from 16 as the thing, you get reduced rates. Go for it.
Yeah.
Figure out who your roommates should be. Go.
Sometimes we can do that, sometimes we can't.
Yeah.
A lot of conferences do that, but they don't sponsor the majority of the attendees.
Right.
But it's the sponsoring is trivial to do. You give the people another code. You say like a promo code and with the hotel. If somebody comes with that code, then it's our invoice.
From my experience, I'm wondering if we could make a mock-up of this and explore the value of the scenario for different people. So I was sponsored. So it was in my annual best interest to book the flights as early as possible. So I needed to know that I would go. But I couldn't buy the flights for quite some time because I didn't know all the details. But we bought it as early as we could to get the cheapest flights to ask for the least amount of money.
This is a common problem with their conference. Bob's team always tries to do sponsorship as soon as possible. So
but you have a very good idea.
Did we succeed this
year?
I think you need to incentivize people. Which is exactly when the lowest price
yeah.
is.
And
yeah.
I understand that you can't do first come, first serve because there are people that you would really want to be there that will do it only later because of job commitments, and most of those would be DDs. But I do think you could reserve 75% of things really for people who come first serve, and that is 6 months in advance.
That's not a conversation for this group, I'm afraid. It's
right,
like,
yeah.
That's for sponsorship teams.
If you do
yeah,
this year and you experience,
yeah, this is the best it's ever been.
It's been much, much worse.
and you're here. Come on.
Okay, more pertinently, I'm sitting in this meeting for an hour and a half and bored. Can we get something?
There's the door.
Do you need me here?
Well, so
it's up to you.
What
you
do
you
want
whatever
to
you
get
want.
To? Like, okay, so I made my point. You could make your point.
I don't want to make any points. I want to help. I don't know the system well enough, so I want to know, are these requirements good enough? Have we captured everything that we need?
No.
What else do we need?
I put a couple of points further down. Some of them are much less important than others. But I think this one is the next one we could possibly talk about, which is the scope of the system. And it relates to the comment from IRC earlier on about the question, you know, are we going to create a, we have a German saying for a milk-giving something. Are we going to create, what is the thing that does everything?
Egg-laying
wool milk
pig, of course.
Yeah, egg-laying wool milk pig. What should be in the system and what shouldn't be in the system?
And does it have to be just one system?
No. Or could it be...
We're living in the age of microservices.
It is already not just one system, right? The volunteer system is kind of tied into Summit, but it's not Summit. I don't know how tightly it's tied.
Not much. We recycle the attendee, but because first them see that volunteers are volunteers forever, it's less tied to a conference, so then we have difficult to link to a user profile.
Okay.
I think it's good to have separate, but it's not so tight because we have two different structures.
The one thing to say against microservices and using different services is that it's probably going to be a different UI paradigm every single time around, and sometimes we might have volunteers who just want to help and don't really want to faff about with learning different systems. Definitely, I think that is a big concern when we are facing attendees. So at the moment, even the fact that our website and Summit are like different HTML backends servers is weird to some people, and we didn't have the sponsors list next to the schedule, for instance, until like Daniel and Kate hacked it in 3 weeks before the conference or something like that.
I mean, good microservices is not a different UI
yeah.
every time.
Actually,
it's just all little Django apps and they connect
right.
together well. And it doesn't have to be a massive monolithic thing.
Okay, so we're at the level of Django apps, and then we're probably also at the level of providing some sort of abstraction. And there was something that occurred to me the other day, which is literally that conference management is really resource planning in so many ways. Whether you're talking about assigning people to rooms that they sleep in, events to rooms, speakers to events, volunteers to tasks, and so on and so forth. The list goes on. It's all the same problem, just with different names or variables on it.
And who can change what when?
It's a very similar problem. It's not the same problem.
But I'm thinking, can't we have an abstraction layer where we make this?
But it's not the way
no.
that's
so
a
database
think so.
Join.
At yeah, at the fundamental level, all you're saying is we have entities and they have relations. Which
yes.
is true. I mean, that's universally
yeah.
true.
Yeah, but look, the problem, for instance, comes with auditing. So we want to make sure that we record every change. Now, you implement the volunteer management, you implement the sponsor management micro app on Django. Do you want to implement the auditing interface yourself?
Would it just be in PostgreSQL as well, direct in the database?
That's one way to do it. But do you have you don't have the authentication information then? Only if we do it, if we actually use SSO to log into the PostgreSQL database to make the change.
Why would you have to log in directly to the database? You could have another API for that.
Yeah, but that's what I'm talking about.
That's what she's saying as well.
I think we're in violent agreement, it's fine.
Violent agreement.
So,
but
the
microservices thing. So I think the thing is to have the data in the same database. Like, we have...
To do it accessible through the same interface. That's the important thing.
Well, okay, so what I mean is, I have the attendee data that has their name, their dates, their email, and I want to add in which room they are sleeping.
You
right?
don't have to go to log on to a completely separate system and do that. You shouldn't have to.
Right.
Yeah.
I'm not talking about the UI. So what I want is that if the attendee changes their dates on the registration system, this is reflected on the room allocation system because it's the same dates.
Mm-hmm.
I don't care if the UI is separate, but the data is there only once.
So the requirement you have there is absolutely correct, and it can be done either with one big database or with separate databases that are related.
It's just normalized.
Right, so
it's just normalized
one.
Data. That's
yeah, yeah, yeah.
So, but you're absolutely right about that.
My point is not having the data duplicated, because if it's duplicated, you need to be like updating and
yeah. And there's so much room for error.
Yeah.
We're kind of getting into low levels of architecture,
sure.
So I know you like that. It's probably a distraction from where we need to get right now. But I mean, I think the general requirement that however we do this, they need to be, the information that we have in one system needs to be accessibly transparently from other systems. So like volunteers right now is really hard because it's not really hard, but it's harder because it's separate and there's not a good connection between them. Or not a really, like, automatic connection.
Yeah. I'm just reminding you all that Hodgestar is getting comments in the Hodge DevCon team channel on IRC. I don't know if you're all following.
I'm just saying hello.
What's the important comment you just made that you wanted to?
No, nothing. It's just there's been a stream of them, and
okay.
we're often not paying attention.
Well, we're not, but unintentionally.
If you want, you can repost it.
Yes.
And copy and paste.
Okay, I'll put them in.
Hello.
Is there no, that's not what we're saying.
Yeah. If he's okay if people read them later.
Thing.
And reading through them, it does look like we've managed to cover.
Yeah.
So that's good.
The thing about the auditing at the database layer, I think that's a good approach to do if we can make sure that all the data that we need are there. But in general, like when you say multiple databases, I go crazy because the one thing you don't have between multiple databases is consistency. Insurance, like the AC ID asset thing that databases give, right? And
I don't think that's a huge deal.
It's a solved and solvable problem. The reason I'm concerned about the one big database is it's a very, very fragile, brittle approach. And it is, you actually get a whole lot more flexibility to evolve over time if you encapsulate your databases in a way that, it's almost like encapsulation for object orientation. Right? It's almost like microservices is almost that level of, it gives you just a cleaner way of thinking about things.
But
so
can't you do that within the database? I mean, you can
use
schema.
You can do it with just separate tables in a single database. You can.
Okay, but it's like, that's what I mean.
Yeah, you're talking about architecture again.
Yeah, I'm getting way off. So it doesn't really matter. That lovely architecture doesn't matter at this point. But yeah.
I did want to make this one point about the consistency. I mean, maybe I'm just a burnt child after these last 4 weeks of handing registration data and feeding it to the venue and every day spending 20 minutes with the venue discussing about things that didn't work out as we had recorded them in Summit. And a lot of the problems stem from the fact that the data are inconsistent between the various sources that we have. And therefore, I would like to actually have a very stringent database design that forces us to have consistent data. And if you put like, you know,
I think you're agreeing with Malga.
I think so, yeah.
What are these different sources? Are you saying that between Summit and your pilot of spreadsheets?
LibreOffice
spreadsheets.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, because there was like.
You're going to have duplication whenever you create a spreadsheet. That's.
Yeah.
Yeah,
that's
I don't want
works.
Any spreadsheet
no,
ever again.
Some of the problem is in our database that we
didn't
design so good, and we asked twice the question about sponsorship. So somebody put sponsorship only on one side and not in the other. They are such inconsistency that I think it's independent of the database.
So
we should care better when we put online this.
We all care about the requirement equally. The exact implementation detail of how we make sure we have that consistency is something we can make for later.
I just trust Postgres a lot, and I would like to have Postgres enforce a certain set of base rules.
I have had Postgres terribly, terribly messing up on that. So, I don't trust Postgres as much.
But that's the design. But you were making about your concern with conversations with the venue. Once you've got people able to change live data, change dates, you're going to be out of date every time you go in because somebody will change the data, even if you're looking at the live data set.
Well, yeah, and
but it should be a smaller amount of change between each day. I accept that.
We need the ability for data to lock down changes.
Yeah, but then what do we do? Like someone writes in and says, oh, I had a whatever kind of emergency and I'm arriving to the legislature.
Yeah, but then we need to figure out this is the problem that we were trying to solve before the conference. That's fine, of course, that is important information, but we need to ensure that it eventually trickles all the way to the venue in a sensible way. And at the moment, I can tell you the way is not sensible. It's terrible at the moment.
After a certain point, can you not say, yes, we have that information, regarding the accommodation, you need to tell the hotel?
Well, the hotel is going to demand, I guess, a freeze of information, and you're paying the rooms whether they're occupied or not after a certain point.
Right.
Actually, we're debating at the moment.
if you can get a better deal than that, that's fantastic, but we've got to accept at some point that's going to happen.
If you can allow people to change things, but the change doesn't actually get applied, and they have to put a justification message next to it, and that gets sent to the order folk, and then they can say, yes, I agree with that. They then know that that person isn't going to be there for two more days.
I think we should do it in Git.
No?
Patch
yeah,
approval work, well.
Cool. Then they can do it on the plane and just push it as they get the Wi-Fi again.
If you don't manage to submit a pull request, you're not worthy of this conference.
All right.
Scope of the system, we kind of wandered off on a side question of implementation details, but the scope of the system is partly a question of what do we need to implement ourselves and what can we reuse from other places. And I think that was kind of where you started, was should this system handle like all of the scheduling accommodation, web content, volunteers, video team planning, all of that, or do we focus on the few things that we really need?
Well, I think you answered that question anyway. The overall system, or at least the UI, should, but whether it's made of a myriad of little systems underneath
is
an implementation question.
Yeah.
But just to understand what you're saying, so microservices, all good and well. I mean, obviously, it's best if the registration team handled or front desk was in charge of the Summit Django app that did the front desk check-in process, so that if they don't like something or need to add a new field, they can quickly change the code, because everybody here can probably do that, and deploy it. So deployment is another point. But all these little apps, they do go to a central source of data, and it's not separate databases that then somehow need to interface with each other. So we do have one machine that provides the database and all the infrastructure, web server. And so
I live in a world where all the services communicate over REST APIs, and they are completely separate databases, and it doesn't matter, they are still synchronized. And
yeah,
I would expect the databases to be different.
It's
because different teams are going to be running their own systems, which has got to you're going to look into it.
But
it's
2015, that's how things work now.
As long as you want them spreadsheets.
Fine, but
if we aim to do this very minimal thing and then plug other pieces, it's more likely they will have something soon. If we aim to this, so
yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Sure,
and
no,
then exactly
yeah,
that
yeah,
will
yeah.
spend a lot of time in this ideal and to have something that will cover everything and we want.
No, no, totally agreed. But we need to make sure that, for example, for next year, we don't need room accommodation, room allocation, because everyone is in a single room, so nobody has roommates. It's just like 1, 2, 3, 4.
We
five.
Do have.
It's
well,
very
we have a choice between single rooms and family rooms,
okay.
So we'll have to have that level of
okay.
choice.
Can
but,
we start the FAQ now?
But we don't need like the accommodation system that allows someone to drag and drop people into rooms. That doesn't need to happen for 2016.
However.
We would like to have the possibility of eventually developing that for 2017. So we need to make sure that our system allows for this thing to get developed in the future, even if it doesn't happen now. But it needs to be possible. That's it.
And that's, so my bigger concern on scope is not scope of all the things that we need eventually, but what are we going to work on in the next 6 months?
But that's, a, that's
for,
the question.
For next year.
That is the question. I know we can create a gigantic, what is it, egg-laying, no, wool, pig.
Translations are hard.
That's never going to get us anywhere. That's no question whatsoever. And obviously, if we have interfaces, I'm failing to sort of imagine how that's going to work. And because I'm a burnt child of this frickin' registration process.
I think they're both talking about the same thing. You just want a thing where there's definitely a piece of data is definitely in only one place.
So,
but it doesn't need to be on the same hard drive as
yeah.
an unrelated bit of data.
What's scaring us?
As
about
long as they're always in the place that they're meant to be in.
What's scaring us about what you're saying is it means we have to write all our own systems. We can't reuse other people's things.
But how would we reuse other people's things?
Like we're doing with the what's it called?
The volunteer.
The volunteer thing. Yeah. So you do an SSO from the main system. Or something that links to the profile that just says this user ID there.
Can I do one more thing then?
What's your pick?
What I told you about.
Yes, it, sure.
Yeah, which then also means that an attendee can sort of draw up their own timetable with from their profile, for example, bringing up the volunteer commitments they've made, talks that, that they've sort of marked that they're interested in. I would really like to see that because it just seems a lot more sensible than they can consult their own thing.
If you want to do something like that, then then some central system would have to ask the schedule system what things is this person interested in, and the volunteer system what things is it interested in, and combine them. And that's
yes.
not hard.
But
I think it would be very
convenient. If we look at a system that does like just lay out a good timetable, allow people to book their things, and then like a volunteer management system that allows to have, you know, certain roles filled for every time thingy.
Mm-hmm.
We're talking about, I don't know, in between half a year and 1 man-year of work. That's
yeah.
about the work that is behind that. So I think realistically, you either use one that exists and that's close enough, or you won't have it.
Well, there's another thing, which is right now, if it's all one system, then the small team of people we have to work on that one system are the only people that are ever going to do that feature, and no one else can do it. If we design it from the start as separate things that are linked together with proper authorization, then we can tell someone, look, here's the authorization piece that you need to use. You can create your own Django app. It's completely separate. It has a separate database. It doesn't interfere with anyone else's work, but it can pull data from the other pieces.
That's kind of what I want.
And it gives you a little bit more flexibility to say, oh, you want to make that? Great, go do it. Here's how you do it. Which Penta kind of had. People added pieces to it over time. Summit really hasn't, because it's very much like forces you into the Summit. If you want to do anything, you have to do it the Summit way.
The conclusion of this all the time is Penta wasn't that bad at
it.
I didn't want to say it out loud, but it
was Ruby.
Yeah, it was
probably.
But it wasn't
so
that bad after all.
How does the system, I mean, I'll out myself as being a non-microservices person. I can understand it, but I don't implement these sort of things. How do I ensure consistency between
you don't,
two systems?
And it's usually not a problem. You can have millions and millions of objects and one or two inconsistencies in there.
So the way you ensure it, if you have something you absolutely need consistency on, it has to be consistent, it only lives on one service, and all the other services have to pull it from that service. That's how you ensure consistency. It has one authoritative source.
Yeah.
But it doesn't mean everything has to be in the same database in the same big Django application.
Okay, but it does mean that things like transactions are not necessarily possible. Or does REST give you the possibility of transactions?
No, it means transactions are not necessarily possible. And if that's a problem, you can implement a cleanup script that goes and that runs every now and then and looks for orphaned objects. But in
practice, that's how you come from the 2015 modern federated systems back to cron jobs of the 1980s.
why did we have all this database design in between?
That's just for fun. Usually don't do it. You do an object database and then it all creates itself.
If you want to, you can do a two-step commit thing, but no one does that. It's hard.
So for taking, once again, the room allocation thing as an example, there would be like a central service that has the attendee data, that has their name, email, dates. Those are there and can only be changed there. Mm-hmm. And the room allocation system would collect this data and like get all the information from the attendees and then like drag and drop people into rooms and assign the rooms. Right?
And then store the data back in the central source.
No,
it's
not.
It's a foreign key.
It's a very foreign key.
So like if you're working on the interface for accommodation, all the accommodation data gets stored in the accommodation system. But the piece that has to be authoritative is remote, and that is who the attendee is, what their attendance date are, and their sign-on, their single sign-on. Like that's the difference.
Let's assume we have that. Let's also assume that we have this micro service that handles payments and finance, accounting, and so on. Right? So now I need to report to the venue who is going to attend, what room they're going to be in, and how much they're expected to pay, for instance. So that means that I now have to ask the accommodation system for those data, and I have to ask this, and then I have to merge the data.
Yes, only apply when you need it.
It's exactly the same as doing an SQL join. Exactly the same. It's just a different way of doing it. But it really is.
Because it has
the
same UUIDs and.
Yes. It's still a consistent system. It's just using a different mechanism, making it a consistent system.
And if you want to, you can push summarized data into a centralized system. When a room gets allocated, you could update something in the profile saying there's a room. When they make a payment, you can update something in the profile saying they've paid this much money, even though it's actually over 20 transactions.
Is there anything that's that would stop us, or is it a bad idea that, considering we already have toyed this idea of tags, that we enforce storage of the authoritative data, even for room allocation finance, in the sort of namespace allocated to that team in the tag database that is authoritative on the authoritative system. So that room allocation, so that at any point in time I can just connect to this database and I can have all the information that I want.
You're talking about a reporting database, basically, and you can actually do reporting databases as a separate aggregated process that's run by a cron job, but the only reason you would do that is if you were dealing with like millions and millions and millions of records and it was just too slow to pull the data on the fly. The level of data we're dealing with.
Where does the accommodation system live? Is that still on the same machine?
It's still probably even on the same machine.
But Alison, you wouldn't do that.
You don't
want to
catch
that.
Right. Well, so the only reason you would create an aggregated database like that is if you were having trouble performance problems.
Mm.
Otherwise, you don't actually need it. Like, you'd still get the data instantaneously. You need to run a question, you get the data instantaneously, you have it, you're done. You don't actually have to.
But I don't have a single point that I talk to.
You do.
Right?
You
do.
It's just the behind the scenes. It's going off and getting the data for you.
Okay.
It becomes a multi-tiered system.
The only thing you need to be aware of that's important, you should just need to know a map of, is this information already on the system? And that's true of any database. Don't go and create a new field in your system if it already exists in another system. And that's the only thing you need to make sure.
But then
we have to do that anyway.
But then we don't need any tags in the central database, because effectively everybody who needs to associate any additional information with the existing data set is just going to do it themselves.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I have a practical question. Is it possible, in the scope of this DevCon, for a couple of people to sit down and make a very, very simple mock-up of what we're talking about?
I don't know. I doubt it. I think it's probably something that's going to happen after this
DevCon. I'm just asking, like, you know, name, t-shirt size, and this database, and that's it. Let's just see how the pieces work together, and so that we can actually play out the deployment process.
Have we actually gotten to the point where we're deciding that we're going to implement that piece ourselves?
No, but I figure that
who
this is
ourselves
this
also.
Is
who
part.
Is the
but our DevCon volunteers. We'll just say DevCon volunteers.
But
this
is,
yeah,
but
this is I would consider this
question.
To be part of the decision. You know, because you need to understand what the scope is.
So if I wanted to give you a mock-up of that right now, I would hand you Wafer and say, go play with Wafer. It's an example. It's architecturally separated. It's designed to have multiple plugins and services. It does the archival into static HTML at the end of the year. It's not everything we need. Absolutely.
What
not.
Is missing?
Single sign-on is missing. It doesn't take payments directly. It uses an external payment.
It's a very simple conference management system. It has talks, it has speakers, it has attendees. That's kind of it.
That's
brilliant.
That can just be expanded with all those modules.
But it is prepared to have a lot of other services that interact with it. Does
it
have
REST
APIs?
It does have, it already has other services linking into it because it uses external.
So what would stop us from using that for DC16 and hacking all the stuff around it?
Only that we haven't decided to do so yet.
And it might be quite a lot of hacking we have to do.
And whoever is doing it should decide.
Can you quantify the amount of hacking? Like, is there a way we could...
What are the changes?
So the first thing we have to quantify is what features we want to be done by DC16, and then we can say how much would need to be, like, and then you can actually evaluate, okay, would using Wafer and then adding other services be faster, or is it too far away from what we want for DC16 to be what we want?
So that if we were to assume that all we need is attendees, we don't do accommodation, let's just assume accommodation is done by UCT, all we need to know is who is attending the conference, and who is giving what talk, and when are the talks scheduled in what conference rooms. I'm assuming that this is what Wafer does.
Hajstar, he's on IRC.
Yeah.
Do you feel comfortable committing that Wafer right now can do that much without any changes?
A few seconds today.
Yeah.
I'm just enjoying the second CSO. Hajstar, can you hear us?
Actually, Mark,
yeah,
you
he was just
type
commenting.
In,
so, okay. Yeah.
Do you just want to type in the three things that you just said? I think it was three that you just said.
He says, I
okay.
can't. And now I forgot what the question was.
That's okay. It's
so the next one. I can
talk
to
the
we can just
yeah.
change to IRC.
Yeah.
We have experience with that. Very good. He's a salesperson.
No, I mean, he already said earlier that it depends on what features you want. So the specific features that you want, type those into IRC, because I'm pretty sure that, so it's attendees, talks, and talks allocated to rooms. Was that what you said?
No, not app talks allocated, yeah.
Isn't the RESTful
API
quite an important aspect?
It's really easy to add.
So that, I think that is sort of the core conference management idea, right? Everything else we can consider optional. And I would be interested
so RESTful APIs in the
I'd
be happy to work on adding RESTful APIs to that. It's a fairly simple construction. Yes, so this is what, so this is the confirmed mind, so that it does.
It has a feature for listing who sponsors are and what levels they're sponsored at. I don't know what you want, what you're meaning when you say
sponsorship.
But this is something that I would consider almost too DevCon specific right now. And it would also probably be the bursaries micro app that we add on top of it.
But if you look at what Hajstar says, he says,
we do all of these paid added and sponsorship, Pochta confirmed and sponsorship.
Yeah, but
I think they might be talking about two separate things.
Yeah,
it's
not, it's
we separated those two terms for a reason.
Well, yeah.
What I want to know is if we were to use Wafer for GC16, and this is the scope, attendees, scheduling of events, that's it. How much would we have to fix on the system for it to be DevCon compatible?
And that depends on how much of all the things that we want to go in right now.
Only,
I don't think we have to, so of what's
only
there?
Only scheduling and keeping track of attendees, which includes t-shirt size and the whole, like, has attended batch.
Because when we say just attendee, yeah, for sure, Waffle covers attendee, but what we've been discussing here, what we want for attendee, the features that we're discussing since the beginning,
pre-registration and then registration later.
Yeah, and
the
tags,
like adding, well, the tags we said, they would be like microservices. So if we want like Assassin's game, it would be a microservice for Assassin's.
Yeah.
And if we want Conference Dinner option, it would be another microservice for the Conference Dinner option. Then, assuming these microservices are created and written and all that, how does this translate into a form that people can go and click on that has all these questions, like what's your conference dinner option, do you participate in Assassin's, etc.
If I was doing this, I would put the conference dinner option into the registration thing here by first. Assassin's probably as a separate system that here's a link to sign up Assassin's if you want to do Assassin's.
Right, but the thing is, we don't want to have the database have all these fields, like conference dinner option, or data options. We want it to be dynamic because each year we want to ask different things because there's maybe no conference here.
So the way
you may change the microservice for each year.
Wait a second. We only support one conference at a time. It doesn't support multiple conferences in the same database. When you finish with a conference, you make the site static and you start a new conference.
So the next year you add whatever special.
Which we said earlier is a feature and not a bug.
So that's the thing that is away from what we're thinking about.
We said we wanted to have a static export every year.
Yeah,
but it's not the same.
We also want the same database.
Well, you can copy, you can use the data and start over.
You can export the users or you can keep the users.
Exactly.
You can put conference dinner in a different table to the user, like conference specific stuff in different tables to the users, and just keep the user table the next
year. The user table from and you can also set it up so that every DevConf back into the dawn of time is available in a single web interface that's linked in. So you can say, okay, this user, I'm checking in. Oh, let's see, for the past 10 years they signed up for Assassin's, so probably they want to sign up for Assassin's again. You can
big
do
data.
Things like that.
Can you also say for the past 10 years they signed up and didn't attend? So then, or they signed up and changed
so
the
useful.
Confidence
yeah,
of how good their data is based on previous attendees.
Or just sponsorship? No.
Are we
did it the last two. So.
What?
Scale.
I was reminding you just a little bit.
Just all those microservices that we are planning to develop, are we planning to develop it in a way that we keep using the master thing? Like, we're not forking as we did with Panda and Summit as on the same, we completely changed it and then it became this thing, this DevConf master.
We became upstream.
The idea was that you keep the Assassin's game out of the conference management system. So that maybe there's a link from the conference management system to say, click here for Assassin's, and then suddenly you signed up for Assassin's, but Assassin's is a separate thing.
And it should look
yeah,
the
yeah,
same and act the same.
Yeah, yeah.
You feel
but
like
you're talking about
system.
Whether the software
just
becomes
that we
a core.
Don't repeat the thing we did with the test two component management systems that we
yes.
And then
yeah. So it's not like somewhere where you end up with like a whole stack of modifications on it that we can never merge back upstream into something.
Maybe nobody cares about
Assassin's. Like it really is all based on single sign. Once you've got that, everything falls into place.
The
problem with that is, if I understand correctly, Denim in general has two single sign-offs.
Am I sending a contradiction in turn?
Yeah. So we have Python code now that
access login with two single sign-on systems. It's not brilliant, but it does work. I mean, and what it comes down to is every single system has to use, whatever we use, every single system has to use the same plugin for sign-on.
Was that question not about, can we avoid forking the thing?
Yeah.
I think we can avoid forking the thing, can't we?
So the way you use WEFA is you don't deploy it as a system. It's a library that you include in your conference, which is a Python Django app. So instead of forking it, you're building on top of it.
Right, and if extra features we need, we could probably push upstream.
Core features we push upstream, things that are very specific to our needs, we keep in our conference, it's built on top of it.
Yeah.
Well,
create is a separate library that we put upstream as an optional addition. So I think we have a plan.
I have a couple of more questions.
Yeah.
Okay, you argued like you would take assassins out, fine, completely optional. Conference dinner, you would put in. I'm already a little bit skeptical about that because how are we ever going to decide like the conference dinner makes sense as core part and not. But let's assume for a minute that the conference dinner is not a core part, or that for instance, like roommate preference indication is part of the microservice that the accommodation people use. Is there, and I think that was your question, how are we going to present, can we, across these microservices, present a single form, a single experience to the people, and have it all work behind it?
You can either way. Whether it's a tick field, whether it's a field in the same database, or whether it's a separate one, you can still provide an interface that does it all as one form.
I think if you want the same UI, what we don't really want is microservices for these things. We just want separate Django applications in the conference system.
So
what's the difference between a Django app and a microservice?
Just the way the data is moved around, essentially.
Yeah.
That's the only difference.
It seems like a big difference.
Implementation details.
It relates to everything.
We need to have the information.
At least one at a time.
Right now, I don't want to be implementing 100 microservices, or even 2 or 3 before DC16. So right now, all I want is what we need for DC16, what the core is going to be, and let's get that working. That's what I want right now. The question of whether when we add things on, that's like we're not even doing accommodation this year, that's fine. There'll be a tick box that says, do you want single or family? That's fine. That's it. Right now, like that's all I want.
But that's what I was asking. Attendance has checked in, has received badge, t-shirt size, events, schedule them to different rooms. I'm assuming it's the scope of WEFA, and I want to know, if we were to put WEFA in place right now, how well would it perform in the DevConf context? What are the DevConf peculiarities that we could not represent in WEFA right now?
Single sign-on was the big one, or the dual sign-on.
Okay, the single sign-on we started with last year. We never used it before, and I never thought it was important.
It already has GitHub single sign-on implementation. We just have to.
Because the hard drive is full of one.
The stomach is empty.
So we started or almost started saying like we really want this tag feature that we want teams to be able to add things from a location, which is just like one example, but we will have teams that want to add stuff to the registration form.
That would be
pretty
easy to add. So WEFA doesn't have that now, would be easy to add. So we could say that's a test, like how hard would it be to add that? I can't tell you right now, I haven't.
Right, but in that case, it would not be a separate database. It would be a separate table in the same database that has these dynamic fields that
anybody can add a tag that they want, and then make an entry that associates that tag with that individual user. Yeah, it's two tables. One lists all the tags, and the other lists all the tags.
Right. Yeah. But this would be in the same database.
I would use NoSQL.
It would be possible to have it in the same web form, because that's the thing that scares me. I understand signing up for assistance can be a separate thing, but for other things, we really want to have the information in the same form.
Yes.
Okay.
that's totally doable.
Wafer has it right now that you have to add to the main database schema for the user and build that up. You can totally do it as a separate tax thing, and it would actually be easier because it would involve less changes from year to year.
Right.
So at some point in time when we talked in BC 16, I floated the idea of deploying Wafer and doing a shadow DC 15 registration.
That we didn't have time for.
Okay, yeah, but that's, the system exists now and could be played with.
Yes.
Yeah, it's up in the cloud. I can give it to
Excuse
you.
Excuse me.
If you
can keep talking, but we're going to stop the video here.
Okay.
We should take a break.
Yeah, we also have to go eat, so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Next plans?
How about we eat?
Next plans? Are people interested in reconvening again after, like at 2 o'clock? And keep talking?
I think there's a thing at 4, but apart from that, fine.
Or should we take a break and touch on Wafer a bit, and so people actually understand what things
get
like
some
that.
Information?
I think we captured a lot of their requirements. I think we captured a lot of their requirements. Thank you guys. We may be able to get volunteers, but let us know.
In advance, because some of us have to go set up video, we don't lose.
I think
we're
done
with
payment,
so thank you.
I think if we want to use for impact on Wafer, we need far fewer people in the room, just 2 or 3 people. We can look through it.
But what this room could tell us is, are there two things you could tell us? So tags is one. Is there another thing? So two stages of registration, would that be our other primary, that we want a lightweight registration and a confirmation registration?
Yeah.
Is there something else that is absolutely critical?
I think the thing that we mentioned about dealing with professional folk in a way that means we can take their money and make them happy would be quite good.
That we probably can't do this week, but...
Well, yeah, the associating profiles would be nice.
Right,
but we don't need to do everything this week. We just need to know that it's possible to have it by October or November. With many of us working on this, so it doesn't have to be you doing all the work. But would that be possible? If we know that it's possible, then we can recruit people to you handle this, you handle that, and we work together on this.
I think what would be a good use of maybe the 2 hours in the afternoon is for the two proponents of Wafer to sell it to us. I mean, get me excited and I'll help.
I think the group, since the beginning, I think that we should have who is implemented it, who is already working on it. I think they are, but and other people, and the final decision will be with them. Because if they start to do something and they see that it's not doable or whatever, they can't take another decision.
That's what I mean. Excite us, hire us, recruit us.
But I don't see, I haven't wanted to do that from the beginning because I don't think there is a universal perfect system. It doesn't exist. It's more a question of for the next 6 months, are we better off spending our effort rewriting everything that Wafer has or recognizing it as a small kernel and we can use that for the pieces it does and we can do our own Django apps and microservices to build on
And I think we all have enough experience to say that NIH is bad. And rewriting everything from scratch is probably going to end us nowhere. But I don't think we have enough. I don't have enough information yet to say Wafer is the ticket. Let's go. So maybe we could use that time.
So that's why I'm suggesting what we do is we add tags, and we see if we can add 2 levels of registration.
Fine.
And from that, we can actually do a more reasonable evaluation of.
And
we
need possibly some. Test system because content team is not happy with summit meeting, dealing from meeting. Yes, they want to see that it will be easier to schedule to assess the workflow for the
So we do have a testing, right? We have a testing set up, but what we didn't do is we didn't have time to. I wanted to populate the web interface with an exact copy of the DC15 web interface, and I wanted to populate the data with an exact copy of the DC15 talks so people could actually play with it, and I don't know if we haven't done that yet. So we might be able to put in a few fake talks, just some fake stuff. And just let people actually try it out.
Because now we speak about the registration, but it's important that it can make happy also the content.
So there's a system that Cernia is called Indica, which has many of the features. So the can look in privately. I don't know if you're not familiar with some, so I don't know how they compare, but I can show you the access to
fundamental features that we need from the system. And I think we also have the understanding that Wafer, as currently represented by the two over there who have most information about it, is a suitable lead that we should follow. And that all I'm asking is, and this is me personally, if you want help on the evaluation, then I need to have more information. And I think using the time at DevConf to explore the system together, for instance, by me shoulder surfing you implementing tags, after I understood the system
would it
a little better.
The original idea is to find someone that doesn't actually know to implement that, which is meant to be.
So
it's meant to be in
pair programming.
You know what I mean? No,
yeah.
So the problem is that we always end up with one person that knows how to tweak everything, and they then.
But
well,
I'd be the best shoulder surfer like that. Then I'd be like, why is that?
Yeah, so if you
I'll happily mentor anyone who's working on anything in Wafer.
Yeah, so if you did it as if I fancy you implementing this feature.
Sure.
What's it written in?
I think we should try to assemble this team, this working team now, like how to send the call for help.
So
asking for help with the. With design, with CSS and whatever, but we should also make a call for more people. Like I think since we are here, it might be easier to get people together and have these 3-4 people that might commit to help. I think it's easier than we going away and then all the weight in your shoulders.
Yeah, that shouldn't happen.
But it has happened in the past.
Yeah.
So
what's your available
life
for a hack? Like, I know you've got a lot of video team stuff, so what's your availability
when?
For like an hour? Just any time. What would work, what do you think might work for you?
Today we can probably find time. Tomorrow morning we can probably find time. Next week.
Because I want that maybe Gunnar, Ganif can evaluate, because they were the maintainer of paint. They know.
But Gunnar is not here.
No, but
themselves.
I'm here CEO. Some comment about what was wrong with Penta and what are the big problems in Penta.
Right, that's fine, but this is a separate thing.
Yeah,
so
but
she was asking about
I mean,
the hacking
more
session.
In the afternoon or there is some time that
that
can be
online. But that's
sure
not a hacking
it
session.
Yeah,
it would
sure.
not be useful to have a hacking session transmitted through video. I don't think that would work. So it's kind of two things here. The first one is let's do a hacking session for folks who would be interested in digging into the code, and maybe just add tags. Like we could work together and just add tags, and then after that we do an evaluation session where we actually like talk through like, well, how hard was it? How easy was it? Does this look, you know, like sort of like reflect back on what we did?
Maybe we could schedule a doc session for the end of next week. Like we will have 1 week to hack and to evaluate and really schedule an ad hoc session to try to reach agreement after 1 week of work.
What I would find really useful too, as there is a sort of barrier right now, which Kate has climbed for Summit, but nobody else has, which is called deployment. If I want to be working on this, on my micro app to handle this and that, I want to be able to commit to Git and essentially, ideally have it working. I mean, I understand that we might want to have two sites and maybe two databases. And
it'd be cool to have it in Jenkins.
But I mean, all of that can be automatically.
We make sure you haven't broken the whole thing.
Yes, it is totally doable.
We can do that.
But that would be one of the first things that if we decided to go that way to implement, because then it allows people to easily play with it.
We want that no matter what system we use.
Yeah,
and if we put it in Jenkins, people can submit to personal branches and see whether they blow everything up before they bother to tell anybody about it, then they'll be less timid about doing it.
But of course, if we start maintaining a test suite, well, that's more work than doing it without a test suite.
Yeah.
Until
the test suite catches the error that was going to screw you during a conference, at which point it's suddenly less work.
It doesn't even need to be as much as a test suite, just the ability for me to push to a personal branch, and then there's an instance that's spawned on Jenkins or whatever, and I can interact with the web interface and try out my stuff.
That might be as much effort as building the conference management system itself.
Yeah,
but
it doesn't
have to be
thinking.
The same people.
Yes. It's orthogonal. It's a different problem.
We may find volunteers who are happy to do just that.
Right, but can we before we have that implemented, can we have an easy deployment process, like with a staging server and a final server, and
the
staging
the
server is actually usable so that I can test what I'm doing?
Part of that's dependent on the infrastructure we get from debian.org, but yes.
Or debian.org, and you can have anything.
Yeah, all that.
The infrastructure right now is I have a free cloud account at HP, and whatever we want. But that's very temporary. So I can give you two of those. If you want another one that we do just for testing purposes, we do that temporarily. But
for hacking, I run it locally on